How many mechanical engineers are there?
Only three.
Electrical? One. Civil? Earth resources?
No.
Electronics? What's your profession? Telephone. Now you all are going to sit for the B paper on 10th of next month. Is this the last lecture? Is there another one? Another three more lectures. Okay. That will be started next week. Right. So you will have submitted your documents, everything, and it's a matter of facing for the B paper and viva and interview. Is that so? All of you have submitted your documents, huh? No? Not yet? Right. You can sit for the B paper at any time. So therefore you are trying to sit for the B paper, and then subsequently you can, yeah, that's also an option. How many of are you aware that the professional PR rules have been amended? You don't know. No one knows. It's a big disaster. The professional rules, PR rules, do you know? That is on 2nd of February, 2nd of March. Yeah, I'll be conducting that talk. Right? Because the, you must be get familiar to the PR rules. Have you, has anyone here who has gone through the existing rules? It's also a question. So why you are, you have not gone through the rules? It's not user friendly. Right? It's not user friendly. So therefore, if someone guides you, you can easily capture that. Right? So that's why we decided to have a awareness program on the PR rules. You know that now the PR rules were amended during last 15 years, the 3 or 4 times. Still, I have seen in the reports the candidates have referred 2003 rules. Even after nearly 18 years. Why it is happening? Because it's the easiest way is to just forget about the PR rules and refer the experience report of a candidate who has passed. That's the easiest way of doing that. And you know that some panel members also have not referred the PR rules. So therefore they also accept whatever you submit that time. And when once the candidate get passed, his successor, his subordinate will follow the same one. Like the in your universities, the courseworks, the one-to-one printing, no? You know the courseworks, the practical is being conducted before the theory class. So then candidate, undergraduates do not know what is the theory behind that. Very easiest way is to get the. Yeah, I also did the same thing, right? But once you become the practicing engineer, you can't do that. Right? You will be get caught. Right? Anyway, because that's something about that. So this is, I will start. This is not a really a lecture, right? I'm trying to share my experience with you all, because I know that you all are experienced engineers working in various sectors for a longer period, but the I have focused this presentation for an engineer who has just completed the minimum requirements to become a chartered engineer. That is 4 years after the graduation. Right? I have focused that one, because if I focus this the presentation or my sharing my experience to very senior engineers, so that is not fair for the engineers, those who start to sit for the professional review with minimum experience. So therefore, please bear that in your mind, right? The focus group I have I am addressing. So you can grab so many things from this one in the engineering society, because we all are in the society, right? So what especially we have to learn about the engineering society, right? Doctor science society, lawyer science society, teacher science society, nurse science society, and engineer science society. So therefore, you should know there should be a difference, right? The engineering society compared with the other professional science society. So this is the objective of this program. And if you come across with any the uncertainty, please call me. Right? Please interrupt. No matter. Now in this presentation, I am trying to cover four areas: the social responsibility, ethics or the professional ethics, and the moral conduct and professional integrity. There are so many the topics you can cover under the engineering society, but I think you all want to go 7 o'clock. So there is the dragging this presentation beyond 7 is not effective, right? Because you will have come after your work, and that will be a very boring session. Even now, you don't feel much comfortable. I understand that. Right? So I try my best to keep you away during this 2-hour period. So if anyone feels sleep, so I feel that is my mistake, right? That is my target. So please help me to achieve my target, right? The social responsibility. So we all know what is social responsibility. Because when we are living in a society, we have certain responsibilities to be served in the society. And also, if anyone wants to get this the PowerPoint presentation, this is available in the ADB website. You can collect it, no matter. The social responsibility. The social responsibility covers its relationship with the external world. Right? Now see the word which is underlined, external world. The social responsibility, because these managerial terms, you can't find the definite boundaries. These are the qualitative terms. You don't have now you all are very good in mathematics, right? But these managerial terms, they don't have exact boundary. You can't find a clear interface between some other similar words. So I will take as much as engineering examples, because by profession I am a civil engineer, and also the related to the mechanical and electrical work as well, I will share with you. Now the very simple, because these are not definitions, right? If I quote the definitions, this will be a rather boring exercise. This is not a management the lecture, right? If you all want to know the management, you can learn in depth about this, the social responsibility, professional integrity, there are the broad meaning, right? The social responsibility covers its relationship with the external world, right? When you come to the world, social responsibility is always dealing with the external world. So then, if there is an external world, what is the internal world? There should be an internal world. These are the, actually there is no internal world and external world, right? When you define the world is world, right? But we use some words, right? External world and the internal world. Now external world means the external environment, right? Now in terms of environment also, how can you define external environment and internal environment? environment is environment. No? Now, it's like this. Now, if you take your organization, the organization is your internal environment. External environment is all the outsiders, excluding the employees of your organization. All the others are at the external world, because your organization serves to the external world, right? The group of members of your organizations are in the internal world, right? This is how it defines how an organization relates with the well-being of the society, right? Now, this is something else to your objective of your organization. Now, for example, if your organization is a construction industry, right, the construction, the your organization provides maybe the shelter for the people, right, comfortable houses, right, shopping complexes, right, for the marketing purposes. There are so many objectives, right, but the social responsibility is little bit different from those main objectives, right. What is your organization, sir? SDNCC. SDNCC is, because I also started my career from SDNCC, right? SDNCC is the former biggest organization. In the PWD period, it was mainly focused for the bridges, but now you have expanded that one into the any kind of works, isn't it? Rather than you are not undertaking the irrigation, no? Buildings, roads, bridges, everything they are under there. Now, other than that, the STNCC has a relationship with the external world, right? Well-being of the society, right? The good example is the very first day I reported for the duty in the STNCC, right? I was posted as a bridge engineer, right? Just after the graduation, right? I was posted in the Victoria Project, Accelerated Mahavali Program. The very second day, we moved to the site and we started establishing our huts. You know the SDNCC situation, huts and the temporary quarters, everything we started. So then, suddenly, we saw one lady, right? Now, this is the construction of new brick instead of the old brick. The old brick will be inundated after the completion of the Victoria Dam. So, therefore, we had to construct the bridge somewhat at a higher elevation. So, we started very second day. One lady came, she tried to jump over the old bridge to the river. So, all the SDNCC group went there, and there was no female with us, all the males, and bring this lady to our the work site. And our charge hand, the charge hand is the minor level supervisor. He is in charge of all the laborers. He is very old person. He started advising that lady, right? And the value of the life, right? That is the social responsibility, right? So sometimes back, this boss would have got married to that lady. It's a different story. That is not the social responsibility. Right. There are things happening. There is a real Palam party, right? We call it Palam party, right? Now you can understand how now deviating for the main objective of construction of that bridge, how you address the society. That is the social responsibility. And if there is a Perihara that area, the STNCC are providing all the post for the flag post, everything, and the lorry to bring all these things, and that is the social responsibility, because they want to maintain a good relationship with the society, right? But those are not the real social responsibility of the professionals, right? Those are social responsibility to any person, right? You need not to be an engineer to look after these type of activities. And for example, taken in ADB and World Bank funded development projects, this is more comprehensive one. The previous example what I gave is that to explain you the social responsibility. Now this is the real example. In ADB and World Bank funded development projects, it is the social responsibility of the contractors, is understood, to conduct HIV awareness program to public. Why is that? What is the main cause of spreading HIV? Migrant people, right? Migration, human migration is the main cause of creating this HIV virus all over the world. So therefore, the contractors, as contractors, I know that the SDNCC also, they bring their permanent staff to the work site, and the minor staff is absent from that area, and they have the interactions, right? Some people, you know, that some people got married from that area, no? And some people vanish, right? Giving some other's name and they vanish. There are so many activities happening in the SDNCC those days. Now still, who is the GM still? He's there, Mr. Vijay Bandara. He's a batchmate of mine. So then, conduct HIV awareness program for the public. Right? So this is a social responsibility of the engineering community. This is more advanced. And maintain effective grievance redress mechanism. What's this grievance redress mechanism? You know, all these affected parties as a result of now, because of the, sometimes you may carrying out certain development activities, right? So as a result of that, there may be temporary disturbances to the society, right? If it is a road project, if there is a small, the hotel, you know, the small hotels by the side of the road, during the construction, the people cannot access to the hotel. So then there are loss of income, right? Who will bear that? The SDICs can't do that. But it's your social responsibility at least to provide temporary access to that hotel. Well, you know that these poor people, once they lost their customers, the customers will move to some other place. So then recollecting the former customers is a big deal. So then you have to provide, right? Sometimes some engineers may think, right, okay, we are doing everything for the benefit of the society, right? Ultimately, all these people are getting benefited. We being engineers, we are moving to some other area, right? Yes, that's correct. But at the same time, we have to think about the others, the social responsibility. Another good example is now the, I'm sharing all these examples because you can quote these examples as your examples when you are writing USA. The another good example is when I started SDNCC, my first job was apart from the brick construction, the rock blasting in that area. Every week we blasted 3,000 to 4,000 drill holes. We had the jackhammers, rock drills, everything. Right? Now this rock blasting area, right, to lower the elevation of the road, and the dust the generator at that area is like the mist, right? Being a young engineer, I could not bear that, right? At that age even. So then I used to get my handkerchief and close my noses. But at the same time, I look, now this is 1981, right? At the same time, all these British contractors, those who carried out the dam site, they had their dust masks. So when I went to the canopy, I went to several pharmacies, and one pharmacy, they said, no, this is what you are looking for. So then I brought one, and it was very comfortable for me. So then I wrote to the DGM and got the permission and brought some the dust mask to the workers. So I gave them one, they were very happy. But later on I observed, when they see that I am moving, they just put the dust mask. When they see I am disappearing, they put that one into the forward and they start that one because they feel it is very uncomfortable, right? Using this dust mask and helmets and all these things, this is very uncomfortable things. But those days I also did not have very thorough knowledge about the repercussions of this, the smoking of this dust. You know, after 19 years time in 2000, so at that time I was working in the irrigation department, we had the construction of Valio. Have you heard about that term? Right? So construction of Valio, there was a tunnel, 1 kilometer tunnel. So I consulted your GM, right? So then we managed to bring that the drilling crew back to the irrigation department, right? So then the sad story I heard was two of my former the gang, the drilling gang, died with lung cancer, two are suffering from tuberculosis. This is the situation. Sometimes I also may be a potential patient of lung cancer in future. That much of dust we smoke without knowing that. But your duty is, the social responsibility is to explain these things. Just verbal information is not sufficient. You have to show at least the videos and other things and convince these people to get rid of these type of disasters. Those are the social responsibility being a professional, right? So now the grievance redress mechanism is, if any affected person wants to inform, right, about the request or his grievance, the person does not know that. What does the person do? He start writing from the president to the Gram Pradhan, right? All over the places he writes, right? Ultimately, right, nothing will happen, right? This is a common situation of this country, not even this country. Most of the developing countries, the situation is same. So therefore, in ADD funded projects, I think now the government is going to implement the same thing, because at the moment I am working for the Asian Development Bank. The grievance redress mechanism. So that means now when ADB start projects, our first job is to form a grievance redress committee. Right? We do the stakeholder consultation. We explain what is this project, how the construction is going on, everything with the leadership of the Gram Pradhan, because the village headman is the most important person until you start the work. Right, he can collect all these people, he is the chairman of that talk. Then if they have any grievance, they can submit it to the Gram Pradhan, and we have informed them once in every week. We meet these people and we explain them how to solve that problem, and gradually when the project is started, right, we develop the mechanism, level of the mechanism. Instead of the Gram Pradhan, then we will appoint the Pradeshalika or the district divisional secretary as the chairman of that part. And we will get down the other key stakeholder agencies to support that part. So like that part, until the project is over, the ADB maintain this grievance redress mechanism. And in addition to that part, if anyone, any two person can write to our ADB Manila headquarters also about their grievances. So now the government also took very good initiative since August 2016, Access to Information Act, that bill was passed at the parliament. Now any person, you know that sometimes some people, some officers, they don't show the right information, because the showing right information will create a lot of problems. So then they hide all these things. Now the Right to the Information Act. So those are the elements of the grievance redress mechanism. Those are the social responsibility of engineers. And take care of public, community, safety and sanitary. I think every project you can see the safety first, and they put up the boards and carry out the work as they want. Okay. And take adequate measures on environmental safety. The green projects. So then this is social responsibility. How you interact with the external world, right? In a professional manner. Not this the meeting the Gamepal Sale Hamudru Hambula Katar. Those are, it's correct, it's not incorrect, but you must be a little professional than to that. So that's why that is the social responsibility of every person. So being an engineer, what kind of social responsibility you can do that the others can't do, right? Only engineers can do, right? So that is the level of social responsibility we are expecting from engineers. So then what is ethics? These are very the related words. the ethics. What is the ethics? Now the main keyword, social responsibility covers its relationship with the external world, right? I explained you the external world. All the others, other than the organization members, right? External world. Now the ethics. Ethics deals go one step ahead than the social responsibility. The ethics deals covers its relationship with the external world as well as the internal world. Then how you extend your social responsibility towards your employees. That is ethics. Ethics is more broader than the social responsibility. Social responsibility always you address to the society, external society. But in ethics, right, you cannot limit your social responsibility only to the external society. You have to address it to your employees. Because unless your employees are satisfied, you cannot give a good output to the society. So therefore, you have to satisfy your internal world people or the employees of your organization. The study of how our decisions affect other people, how it differs from the social responsibility. Ethics is more general term that covers both internal relationship and external relationship, right? That is the, we call it ethical behavior. I think that you have to learn the 7 or 8 ethics in the professional, the B people, right? And out of 8, one question is asked. So if you learn this 8 ethics, right, you can practice that the Girawa system, and you can write to that question, you will be getting 25 marks, right? But this is not that this Girawa system, right? Girawa is confined to that 8 ethics, no? 8 ethics, right? 8 or 9 maybe. This is not that Girawa, right? This is how you address to your internal environment as well as the internal environment for their well-being. This is what ethics. Take some same examples. Conduct HIV awareness program for both public and employees. Right? Social responsibility we address only to the public. Now here you incorporate your employees as well. Take care of safety and sanitary for both public and employees. Right? Now for example, you have a construction site, right? You divert all the drainage water to the neighboring land, right? Maybe it belongs to the government. You think that this is the crown land? No one will object that one. Right? You can't do that one, right? You have to care the safety and sanitary of the public as well as the internal environment. Now, if you go to the camp of the laborers, right? Sometimes, right, there are some contractors, they provide even mosquito nets and all the basic facilities, drinkable water, everything. But there are some contractors, they don't care about that, but they hire a house and give it to these people. Now they are living just like slaves, right? That is not the social, that is not the ethics. It is not ethics. Good. As long as you are serving to the society, you have to look after the well-being of your internal environment, that's your employees, and take adequate measures of environment sustainability within and outside the organization, right? You are trying to get the green certificate, but this is something like the canteen kitchen, right? The canteen provide all the food to the society, but if you go to the kitchen, what would be the situation, right? So if you want to the carry out the fasting campaign, the best thing is go and see the canteen of a kitchen, hotel. Then you can stop taking meals for couple of days, then go to another canteen. Right? So that is one way of carrying out the fasting exercise. Then the grievance redress mechanism for the society as well as the employees. Because the employees are the most vulnerable people. Look, once they start strike, carry out strike campaigns and all these things, they have to stop everything. HR look after that now. And employee's welfare as well as the social welfare. While you are looking after the social welfare, right? Sometimes some contractors, they like to organize the religious exercise at the temple, and they provide a lot of things. But they don't, right? They are not prepared to buy even for a small single thing for their employees. The ethics covers both parties. Now the one side you remember, the we had a project in Colombo area, and the contractor has brought the international contractor. The contractor has the foreign people as well as the local people, and the locals hired from that area, and they have their permanent crew. They are from various places, because you know that most of the contractors, if they find a good person, they want to keep those people retained with them, right? So mix of people from all over the world. So therefore, it was compulsory, the ADB projects. This is part of the agreement. Now, when we are when we put up the notices for calling the tenders for the procurement, we include the if you take the bidding documents, the bidding documents say you have to carry out a awareness programs, number of awareness, different type of awareness programs. One is the conduct HIV awareness. So then the contractor was very enthusiastic person for this type of work. He had a safety officer, safety officer organized a big campaign for that term and displayed notices everywhere and informed to the general public, and he invited us also. Right? So we also went there, and on the day, right, not a single person came. Right? Not a single person. He was very upset. So then I said, no, don't get upset. Then see what he did was he called all his employees, right, for the program, because he has invited the speakers are there, the audience is almost empty. So all the employees came, and the program was successfully conducted. So then I thought, of why this was, why the public is not interested to come that. So I met one employee who was hired from that area, and I asked him, why your family members are reluctant to come there? No, sir, if we came here, my neighbor might think that I am suffering from HIV. Neighbor also thinks like that. So then ultimately it would be like this, and you have can they have it, right? No one has contributed. Right? This is the reason. It's true, no? Those are the cultural barriers. Right? We'll have to identify the cultural barriers, right? As well as we are identifying the construction barriers. We are very keen to identify the construction barriers or the contractual barriers, but not the cultural barriers. This is a cultural barrier. So then what I did was, we found the real story. This is the diagnostic approach, right? If you have the problem, you have to diagnose that one and find the root cause. Then you have to treat to the root cause. What is the root cause? Everyone thinks if that person appears to this HIV awareness program, others might think that person is potential candidate for HIV, something like that. Right? So then we organized another one, right? Even we did not put HIV. It is anti-DB campaign, right? We gave the publicity through the PHI, right? The PHI, Gram Nilsari, with publicity. The audience was full. Then we started first HIV awareness program, then anti-DB. We transferred the message to the audience. Now this is how you have to think. Don't think always being technical, qualified engineers, right? There are some ways and means to tackle the people and address to the society. This is the way of, right? This is the professional ethics, right? This is the professional ethics. So ethics, study of people's values, rights and norms. What are those? People's values, rights and norms. This is very general, right? These are very general, but only we don't care about this, right? We have the material, but we don't compile and see how we could address these things. Now, did I tell you anything that you have never heard? Did I tell you anything that you have never heard? Everything what I explained you, you have heard, but your difficulty is how to compile this material, extract it from the others, and focus through this subject matter. That's it, no? So this is, that's why I told you this is not a lecture. I'm sharing my experience. So then, based on those experience, you think about your experience and write about that, right? So ethics, if I little bit elaborate little more, ethics is the study of people's values, rights and norms. When you are when you value something, either you want it or you want it to happen, because it will give you a gain. Those are the values. Values means if you want something, it should give you a value, right? In different ways. Either it may be increase your comfortability or increase your knowledge. If you want to buy a book, right, you want to increase your knowledge, right? With any experience. So that's, those are the values, right? Now you want to buy a car because it gives you a comfortable journey. Similarly, why you want to have peace? To avoid conflicts, right? But you don't like conflicts, no? To avoid conflicts, you want to concentrate on peace. Those are the values. If anything, if you are adding to your life, if you consider in what sort of the benefit it gives to you or gives to the society, right? Those are values. But if anything which adds values to you, at the same time it makes others value, reduce the others values, those are not values, right? Something like the taking bribes, tappanganna, right? You know that now last few days we heard about this thing. What is that? Mahapadre Madhus, right? That person, it's a matter of giving a phone call. If he want, he can earn how many hundred thousands, right? So then it adds values to that person, but at the same time it does not add values to the society. Those are not values, right? Because for the values there are no rules, there are no regulations, but the society decides, right? The value. So value means it should give some benefits to you without disturbing the benefit of the society. That's the condition. Otherwise you can see anything you want is a value. It's not like that. Then the rights, right? Yes. And sometimes you say, this is my car, my petrol, no? That is right. Your freedom to take a particular action. But rights are always restricted by the other's rights. Your rights are restricted by the other's rights. Now, for example, all these the male gentlemen, right? Now you have promised your wife to come back by 7 o'clock, no? If it reaches to 8, your right is restricted by your spouse, right? That is there. There are no rules, there are no regulations, right? For the well-being of your society in your house, right? That's your, always your rights are restricted by the rights of the others. Have you heard about the in 1989 or in that period? Yeah, there was a big train and school bus crash at Ahungalla. Has anyone heard about that one? Ahungalla, the accident. The bus driver put the bus to the railway track, right? Not the, in the main road, sub road. The train came, and number of school children wounded and died. Right? At that time, I think the president was R. Premadasa, as well as he is the minister to the local government, transport, local government and transport, right? Very next day, immediately move to the place where the accident has happened, right? So then the people surrounding that area came and explained, they started crying, some of their children died, wounded, a lot of things, right? At the same time, the railway department, CGR, is anyone from the railway department? No, right? That engineer, he tries to derail the railway, that means bring the partners back to the railway track, derailing. And then the President Premadasa called, where is that railway engineer? Called him. Right? Then the engineer came, right? Wearing a shawl and wearing slippers. And he's a real engineer, wearing a hat and his hand, there was a stick also. Right? This is how the railway engineer behaved at that time. Right? That's his rights. No? Right? He's well dressed. Can you say anything when he's wearing a shawl? Right? You can't object. Right? No, if he was without any dress, then it's a different matter. But well dressed. So the President Premadasa did not tell anything. Following day, he issued a circular. All the executives must wear. There are three kinds of suits. European one with the tie. Second one is the national. The third one is the property suit. Right? All this the politician fellows are wearing. Either three. So then always we had to keep our ties in our pocket and go to the place when the, you know that, now at that time I was working in the Hambantota, right? Okay. Do you imagine that cannon, not even an engineer, any other person can wear a tie and work in the site? So always standby tie was in our pocket, right? Because we were ready. That's our freedom was restricted by the honorable president of the country, right? That is right. Then the norms. Norms are the regarded as collective representations of acceptable groups. Right? So it's like that. Now during the New Year period, Hindus and the Buddhist people, they have some cultural norms. Right? And the Muslims have different cultural norms and some social norms. Right? So those are the norms. Now these rights, these rights are different from the human rights, huh? The human rights and the fundamental rights, those are different, right? These rights are the what is accepted by the society, right? Always these ethics are confined to what is accepted by the society. The norms are also like that. There are cultural norms, there are social norms, behavioral norms, right? Those are the norms. Now this ethics is a combination of rights, values, and norms, right? This is not a difficult subject. Now you make the subject difficult because you start to think very complex level. Don't try to think complex level. Make it simplified. Right? And think about your example. Now this is one number of examples I gave you. Based on that one thing, how you behave as an engineer in the society. Then we can go another step. Now we started from the social responsibility, which addresses only to the external society. Then we discuss about ethics that will address not only to the external society but also to the internal society. Then we can come to the moral roles and the moral conducts. Now based on these professional ethics, right, the way you are serving to the society as well as the your organization employees, there are some guidelines, right? Those guidelines basically resolve the disagreements, right? Moral rules, they mainly resolve the disagreements. So that means that why the disagreement happened? When you maintain the equity, there are no disagreements, but always you can't maintain the equity. No? You can't, that's practically not possible, right, in a country like Sri Lanka. But as long as possible, you have to maintain the equity, right? You have to treat everyone on the same level, right? So then the rules or the guideline, not the rules, the guidelines. What is the difference between the guidelines and the rules? The guidelines you can change as you want. The rules are established to everywhere, right? You can use your own guidelines, right? I am using my own guidelines, right? So that means if your guidelines direct a person for the good behavior, that's guideline. You can develop your guidelines, right? So moral rule is based on your ethics, right? Your values, your rights, and your norms. If you can develop a set of rules which could direct external world as well as the internal world to the right track, right? That means disagreement free society, that is the moral rules for the good behavior, right? Developing good behavior. So moral conduct, those are the moral rules. The way of implementing moral rules is moral conduct. You have to find out a way of implementing that. The good example is to implement the good practices to how to avoid transferring the A from the in my previous example, right? The way of disseminating this information to the society, what I initially I decided to give a good publicity, right? But was not successful. Why? Every person thinks this awareness program is for the potential candidate of AIDS. So then I changed the guidelines, because you can change the guideline. I changed the guideline, cut the word AIDS, replaced by anti-dengue. Then under that program, conduct anti-dengue as well as anti-HIV. So this is moral conduct. How you develop your guidelines, right, to transfer your requirement to the society. For example, now the way you talk to your immediate subordinate, you can't use the same language when you are explaining that one to the general public, because you have to understand what could be the most easiest way to transfer your message into the others. Sometimes when you are talking with the politicians, I don't want to say the politicians are the knowledgeless people, so they like if you can make a presentation with all these features, they like to hear that, because they want to grab everything in a very short period. So therefore you have to develop your interpersonal skills in certain way that transfer your message to the others for the benefit of the society, including the internal environment and external environment. So that way is the moral conduct, right? Interpersonal skills. What is interpersonal skills? How you develop a good relationship with the others. For that one, what are the elements of the interpersonal skills? Communication, presentation, right? What is negotiation? Listening also, because there are some people, they don't like to listen to others, no? They talk. When others start talking, they disturb them, but they don't like to listen. Listening is also a good discipline, right? Some people like. Now see, sometimes you can't solve the problem, right? But if you listen to the person, right? Now the one good example is when we were carrying out one project in Modar area. You know the Modar area, right? It's a very difficult area, right? And it's the excavation of trenches and lay pipes. So what's up? It's a non-revenue water project. Is any person from the water supply and drainage board? No. Even there is a person, they don't like to raise their hand. Right? They might think that I may ask questions. No, not to worry. Right? So then, after laying this pipe, you have to compact the surface, pre-statement of the surface. You have to bring that to the normal conditions. So when the vibro roller, the hammers hammering, there was a house very close to the road level. And one old lady, right, about 85 years old, she had some the mental disorder. Right? This lady started shouting, right? Because she cannot. Sometimes this the vibration will irritate her mindset. She started shouting and all. So then immediately, his son is also, I think, about 60 years. So that may be that lady might be nearly 90 years, a very old lady, complained that time. And she got a phone, he got a call, and he asked, where is the country director? Asian Development. Then I want to speak to the country director. No other person I don't. So then the country director was out of the country those days. So finally, I told him, the country director is out of the country. If you can give me your phone number, I can ask my country director to get an international call and talk with you. Right? So then this person came down a little bit. Right? I said, no problem. Right? You can give me your free time. Right? I will organize that. If you want to really speak to that. Then he told me, you are only the person, at least you listen to me. Right? So then I realized, now I have come to the camp. Then I said, sir, if I can help you, right, I can talk to you, right? But it does not mean the country director will not talk to you. In the meantime, if you want any information, I can talk to you. Then he said, when you are available at your office, I can come. I said, no, sir, I can come to your place. Then he was more happy. So we went there and I listened to him nearly 45 minutes. I did not talk even a single word. Finally, the person was very happy and we realized it's a real problem. No one has listened to that problem. Do you know what we did? We arranged the compaction of that particular area. We postponed it to 3 or 4 days and we arranged a close by guest house, right, to this lady and his son. Right? We got the holidays and we arranged that, right? And we provided all the transport, everything, and the meals and everything from that guest house. We paid the guest house bill. Right? And in the meantime, we provided some security also to his house. Right? He asked if he can recommend any security firm, we can employ. Right? We did that. And after that, we did the construction and we brought the lady back to that. Now, why don't you think, right? Sometimes we think, what the funny thing we have done. But think, if the same situation was happened to your mother, we take very seriously, right? We take very seriously. So as long as you are thinking that all the others are not our relatives, so that's the biggest mistake. And the moral conduct, another one example, I will share with you. We had a project in Vaunia. Is there any gentleman from the water supply and drain board? No. Can't be, no. Only the SDSC gentleman is here, but I can't ask this question from him. In Vaunia area, there was a project, right? That project is the water supply project. that is the, there is no intake to take the water, so therefore the project contain construction of large reservoir, not for the irrigation, but for the drinking water. And then we store the water from that reservoir and we pump into the towers, the treatment plant, then the powers, and after that the balance work. Right? And during the environment impact assessment we carried out, right, within the area, the inundation area. This is jungle, right? Vaunia jungle. And in the biotic report, I saw there were 3 species, right? Animal species. 2 are land snails like Golubello, Hangul, that one is a butterfly, right? Their conservation status was critically endangered. What does it mean? Because any species, right? Fauna species as well as the flora species. that means the plants and the animals, their conservation status based on the survival rate, we can categorize. The critical endangered means they are almost at the situation to disappear from the world, right? If there is any endemic plant, it's at the stage of disappearing from the world. That is a critically endangered. The next low level is endangered, little bit good. Third level is the vulnerable, right? So there were five categories. The last level was the least concern. Wherever you go, you can see like the cows, the bulls, cows, you can see that least concern, right? So we found three critically endangered species. So what did the ADB do? ADB stopped the project, right? Said, we can't give you the ADB financial support if you are going to inundate this area, because if you find three critically endangered species within this area, normally that habitat is named as the critically endangered habitat, right? Like now our race, we call it the shanties, where the poor people are living, right? Like that, this is critically endangered. They stopped that part. So what I did was, I had to give a solution, right? This is how the we want to eliminate this situation. We will have to protect the life of this critically endangered species. And they asked, what's the solution? All the expert in the biology, they gave a lot of proposals. All the proposals were not accepted by the ADB. So being a civil engineer, I gave the proposal. Right? This is really engineering proposal. Right? Can you imagine the proposal? What I suggested is, we catch all the species into the buggers and translocate them to similar habitat. That's it, no? That is the engineers can do. I don't know their conservation states. Disregarding the conservation states I propose, we are going to catch all the species, the so-called species, right, into the buggers, we translocate them to the similar habitat. All the Golobella, Garantia, Diabaria, Patta, everything, and including that Bhimakurva, we translocate them to similar habitat. So in the, how do you find the similar habitat? Then they ask, how do you find the similar habitat? That was the question. So then, at that time, we used real engineering. So what I did was, I got some satellite images and do a classification to find out the similar forest cover. There are techniques that in the satellite remote sensing you can find out the similar habitat. So using that one, I justified, now this is the area of the similar habitat, and we translocated them, and then after 2 years time we carried out a post survey to check the survival rate of these species, right? Sometimes you may think, what a joke you all are doing, right? But life is life. Your life, my life, the Golubella's life, equal rights. That is the moral rules. Those are not established. But for the well-being of the society, including the environment, you have to carry it out. You have to take your decision. And also, you know that another exercise I propose. Have you heard about during the Mahavali development period, there was no environment, EIS, nothing. We have not heard about that part, right? So that was the time. And after completion of the Mahavali, the biologists found there was a, I cannot remember the name, there was a variety of the fish species. During the breeding period, they have to come to the upstream. They want to have a certain temperature. They normally like to the live in high temperature areas, but during the breeding period they have to come upstream. But because of these dams, they cannot cross. But luckily, some fish varieties were blocked at the upstream also. So therefore, that fish variety is still there. So after that was the lesson we learned. And hereafter, we have to carry out the the survey, not only for the species, those who are living in the land, but also living in the water. We have to carry out that and see whether there are any endemic species, their life is close to the critically endangered or endangered or whatnot the situation. So we have to do that. And in this particular, the reservoir that is called the Peruvara Reservoir in Vavuniya, so I provided a fish ladder. Has anyone heard about a fish ladder? No. Because once we put up the dam, the fish can go downstream, but they can't go upstream. During that tank is spilling, the fish will fall to the downstream, but they can never move to the upstream. The fish ladder is, you go to the internet and just type fish ladder and you can see lot of video clips. The fish ladder is, we created a very mild slope, step by step, concrete tube, right? Rectangular shape, the step by step, right? And have you heard about the buffer blocks in irrigation? That means to the break the speed of the water, we put up some the blocks in between that part, right? So then the water moves like the zigzag way, right? The water path goes inside the tube, we turn to zigzag way, then the speed will reduce. Then the downstream, at the time of the spilling, we watched, right? We had the video clip. For a 1 hour period, not a single fish came to that turn. After 1 hour, one fish came and tried to go along that turn. You know, after 2 hours period, all the fish started like a pirahara, started moving that turn. They are so intelligent, the fish like. That's the first fish ladder we constructed in Peruvara Reservoir. So I invited the University of Colombo to make that as a research area. They can carry out research. This is the professional contact. Always don't think only about the human beings, but also think the life of the species, environment, everything. That is moral rules. You can develop certain rules. This is engineering rules, right? So how to process? Now the moral rule is doing good things, no? What is the best way of doing good things? Sorry? Not doing bad things. That is pansilo. Pansilo paspao. Even Lord Buddha could not define what are the good things. Lord Buddha also said, don't do bad things. Right? Then always we will do good things. That is the best definition, not even the Lord Buddha. All the religious leaders say, don't do bad things, no? That's the threshold value of good and bad. Right? This is everything very related to you, right? But only the difficulty is you have not compiled this information into the certain domains. So once you compile this thing to the certain domains and think about that part, you can develop lot of information. Usually moral rules comprise list of actions from which to abstain. Pansilo Paspao says, please avoid doing these type of things. That's it. Don't think that I am trying to develop the, this is not a religious exercise, huh? Sometimes some person will send a petition, this person is trying to develop Buddhism here. It's not like that. So then we will go to the examples, right? Please write examples, right, in your, and one more thing, actually I am not the person who is preparing the question paper, right? Even I am not receiving the marking scheme also, I don't receive that, honestly speaking. But I expect the person who prepared the question paper will go through this presentation and at least to listen this one and prepare the question paper. The problem is you can talk not even 2 hours, 2 days, 3 days based on the moral ethics, right? Moral conduct you can talk. So if a question is in general forms, right, people can, you can write a lot of things,
And
so then, if a general question is asked from you, by keeping specific things in your mind, right? When you are correcting the answer script, you will give less marks to those who have not written on the things which was in the mindset of the person who prepared the question. I always say that part, but unfortunately, ISL has taken a decision. Preparation of a question should not be given to the person who delivers the lecture, but I said I never delivers lecture. I'm sharing my experience and I'm confined this presentation to 2 hours. Within these 2 hours, I'm covering a very small area. And please ask the question related to that area. Because otherwise, if you ask very open-ended questions, the candidate will be misguided. Right? You are not supposed to learn all these things within these 2 hours, no? Isn't it? Right? So then if you can go and follow an MBA course or something like management course, right? It's not a management exercise. Okay. Few examples. Have you heard about this 1972 jumbo jet plane crash? Right? The story is the cargo door was developed by a subcontractor, conveyor. That was the subcontractor. The McDonnell Douglas is the main contractor, right? He gave a subcontract to the cargo door. Then the conveyors, the subcontractor senior engineer Dan Applegate informed top management of his company, right? The subcontractor senior engineer, sir, the cargo door could burst and open and will lead to a crash of the plane. The senior engineer of the subcontractor says that, but with his experience, he is an engineer. Hence the door that to be redesigned and the cabin floor has to be strengthened. That is the statement given by the subcontractor's engineer to the main contractor. The top management, even the top management at the subcontractor did not take care on the prediction of that. Why? Because liabilities and redesign costs were high. The subcontractor has been given the turnkey package to design and build. Now this chief engineer construction says this is not strengthened enough. You have to redesign that to the top management. Top management disregarded that one because of the cost and the additional obligations and the reputation and so many things. So what has happened? In 1974, the cargo door DC jet, jumbo jet burst open and the jet crashed near Paris, killing 346 passengers, including the cabin crew. Not a single person was survived. Right. Now, what was the reason? Top management was reluctant to bear the cost of pre-designing cost, and they thought this will not happen. This disregarded the engineers. The suggestion, ultimately, that mad decision, right, destroyed the lives of how many? 346 people in this world. So from that one, what is the message? Even the message comes from a small person who have to consider that. Sometimes the Basurna person will give a good solution. Some engineers reluctant to undertake that. So when you are supervising certain things, if you see, you have in your mind, you know what to do, right? You have given the way of doing that part. So when you go to the field, you can see my subordinate, the group, is not following the same way what I have suggested. They are following a different way. Immediately you go and say, what the hell, I have not asked you to do this thing. Please stop that one. Don't do it. Please observe whether the deviated way is better than your or equal, at least the similar to your way. If you find that one, please appreciate. Please appreciate. Right? That is the way of motivating people. Right? Always just don't try to put your kannadi and see whether they are following your instructions. Even they have deviated from your instructions and taken going along the good path, appreciate it. Right? Now in, I heard about this, the DHL, the courier service, the organization. In one December, all the big people of the DHL have gone for the holidays. Right? But for the DHL, the December is the most busy period. All the parcels, the greeting cards, everything moving during the Christmas, the gift, everything moving during the December period. So one manager, one junior manager was the intern, and he found huge number of, large number of the parcels have he has received. He wants to deliver as early as possible before the end of the Christmas. The person took a decision to hire a jet aircraft, hire the aircraft and send those things. If such a thing is happened in our country, immediately boss will come and sack you. Even sometimes we have seen, if a person goes by a vehicle, because I could remember those days the only the AC vehicles were given into the senior executives. Junior executives are not entitled. Those are the people who are working at the field. There are things happening like that. You know what the DHL, the senior management team, they gave double promotion to the person, right? By taking a good decision, right? He violated all the rules. He's not a person to hire an aircraft and send all these things. He did that. So always see whether your subordinates are doing well or better than you. Always appreciate that. So that's moral conduct. And the another example, right? The Carl Wooster, he's a welding supervisor for a nuclear power plant in Virginia in 1970 for Stone and Webster. Weber, that is the company, the Carl Houston, is a welding supervisor, he's a just welding supervisor. And he saw when they are casting the nuclear power plant, you know the how precisely you have to carry out all the joints, welding joints, everything. Because if there is any, the leak, that will create a big disaster. Then he found improper welding procedures. These are experienced welder, use of raw material according to him, and welder, the company has employed untrained welders, and the situation was dangerous. The welder decided that, and he reported to the management, but the management ignored that the welder fellow, he does not know anything, we are the engineers, right? And he simply ignored. But this junior person, he reported to the headquarters. Then what happened? He was fired. Like our big people, he was fired. You are a troublemaker, go home. Finally, that person brought the issue to the Atomic Energy Commission. And investigation confirmed his allegation. He complained to the big place. So then they came and checked that, and they found what this junior person is correct. So then, luckily, this welder took right action at the right place and to the right direction. Otherwise, this story will be, we have to discuss like the jumbo jet story. But this was not happening. There are number of examples you can find how we carry out our engineering practices for the well-being of the society as well as the well-being of the employees. Now see this one, this is not moral ethics, no? Ethics called that you have to look after the well-being of your employees. But this management fired the person. And this is also another good story. This is the City Croc Center in New York. It's a high-rise building, right? And this building was checked by the well-reputed design team in America and constructor. And have you, I think most of you have completed the implant training period, isn't it? Right? You are transferred to the during the undergraduate period, you have to carry out your implant training. One implant trainee, young engineer, right, has worked in a design team, right? And she found the design of this City Croc Center, right? Now that construction complete after 20 years after the construction completion, this undergraduate lady engineer attached to the design team and she found the old design. She checked that one, right? Then she found these arrows are the direction of the wind, and they found this building has been checked for the wind force which is coming right to the face, either eastern direction or the west direction or the north direction or the south direction. When they have made an assumption, the wind is coming right to the face. But this young engineer, she tried to check when the wind comes in an oblique way. Then she found there are places that could not sustain, not because of the previous design, but because of the construction defect. She found some construction defects as well, right? Because of this construction defect, she found when the wind blow comes through the oblique direction, the building will collapse. Then she reported that. Then they carried the construction defect was the original design for the angular braces, you know, the angular braces. This is steel structure, welded joint. However, during the construction, to save labor and material cost, builders use bolted joints with the approval of the design firm. Instead of welded joints, for the welding, it needs a labor. They have put nut and bolts, right? With the approval of the design firm. So then this young engineer found, lady engineer found, because of instead of welding, they have put the nut and bolts, the strength has gone down. There is a tendency to fail if the wind comes at the speed of 70 miles per kilometer or 110 kilometers per hour. Right? That is the conclusion. So then he reported immediately to the design team. Right? Then design team carried out the wind tunnel experiment. You have carried out that experience at the university, wind tunnel, and wind tunnel confirmed that they prepared a prototype and tested that one. This building can stand if the speed of the wind is only for 110 kilometers per hour. The probability of occurring that type of wind is once in 55 years. If you want to take the probability to occur that wind by tomorrow, you divide 1 by 55, right? That's the probability. So then immediately the design team change their design and start up. They can't do anything. What they did was all the bolted joints they replaced by welding, right, to bring the strength back to the normal strength. But luckily during that period there had been a hurricane, right, in that area. But before reaching to this City Croc, the wind direction has changed, right? That saved life of 1,000-2,000 people living in that area. So this also example says Now the all these top level designers ultimately listen to the junior engineers proposals and check that. Always taking precautions, disregarding the situation of the person who proposed that one. Even a beggar can give you a good proposal. Don't ignore that one. And the last example, I think you all have heard about that one. Have heard about the Bhopal Union Carbide case in 1984. The Union Carbide factory was located in Madhya Pradesh of India, very close to the area where the poorest among the poor were living, among the shanties and all these things. Some of our working in the Union Carbide factory. 2 or 3 December 1984, right? There was a gas leak, methyl isocyanate leak, and 500,000 people were exposed. Right? Still, the number died is not confirmed. Right? The high toxic substance made it way into and around the shanty towns located near the plants. The official immediately death toll was 2,259. But the government of Madhya Pradesh confirmed the total death was 3,787. The government affidavit in 2006 stated that the leak caused 558,125 injuries, including 38,478 temporary patients, partial injuries, approximately 3,900 severely and permanently disabling injuries. See the, and this is very similar to the Nagasaki and Hiroshima disaster, right? And finally, the government found this is the Indian government and local activities argue that the slack management and deferred maintenance created the situation. They have not carried out the operate maintenance, regular maintenance, lack of regular maintenance. The water has come to the MIC tank, that is the methyl, the isocyanate tank, was filled by the water. When it is filled by the water, it creates gas like carbide, right? You know what is carbide? It is used for the welding in good old days. When you put some water into the carbide, it creates the gas, right? Because of the lack of maintenance, this has happened, right? How small amount you will have to spend for the maintenance, right? But ultimately, that was ended up with the nearly 500, more than 500 people either partially disabled, permanent disabled, or died in the disaster. Right? Now all these cases says the being engineers, you have to have, don't stick to the only on the engineering designs. Engineering designs will help you to make decisions, but at the same time, listening to the others and think about the life of the people, maintenance, right? Now in government sector, what is the poorest situation? Maintenance. Maintenance work is always cut down, right? Then you don't have maintenance fund. And ultimately, that will be ended up with very big disasters, right? And the finally, out of all these examples, in engineering practice, we learn usually moral rules comprise list of actions from which to abstain. That's the best way of describing that part, because it is, it's very the broader the width. If you are going to explain how the good things, right? It's very difficult to explain what are the good things. They always please avoid bad things, please avoid poor maintenance, right? Please avoid not listening to the others, right? So if so, you can do your, you can make your engineering practices in more ethical and way, and that will give good results to the society, and the people will appreciate you, right? That is, the wealth of appreciation is much more than to your salary, right? So this is called the due diligence. In terms of the management, we call it due diligence. What is due diligence? The minimum level has to be maintained, right? You can't go beyond that one, right? That is the level of due diligence. So you have to ensure the due diligence. In every engineering project, you have to ensure that due diligence by considering not only the product output, but also the well-being of the society, including your employees. Can you remember about a couple of weeks back, one worker's hand went into the press printing machine? The owner, right, cut the machine. The cost of the machine was more than the 10 million, right, to save the hand of that person. He says if the machine operates on the reverse way, right, they will have to cut the hand of that person. But that person, think about the life of the person. That is the moral practices. Those are the ethics, right? Now if you think about very leisurely, you can find thousand odd examples how best we have done and how bad others are done. So then develop your own norms, right? When you are answering to the questions, please quote as much as examples and show that you are competent enough to explain them. This moral rules, social responsibility. Don't write, when we go to the area, we met the Loku Hamuduru, we got all the instruction from him, like that one. Those are very primary level, right? The social responsibility, being a professional. By definition, due diligence is the certain standard of care which is required for process involving an investigation of design, engineering calculations, contracting, consulting, supervising, everything, right? When you are carrying out any process, think about the minimum standards which care not only the product but also the well-being of the society. So we like to know the brick we are driving on will not collapse, or the airplane we are flying will not dissemble in the sky. That is the due diligence. The whole rationale for applying due diligence in our professional undertakings is to protect others from pitfalls resulting from oversight. If you oversight the matters, ultimately that will create lot of disasters. Right. This is the all about the social responsibility, ethics, and the moral conduct. All these things are interrelated, right? Social responsibility addresses the external world, right? Ethics addresses the external world as well as internal world. Ethics is the combination of values, norms, and rights. Values will add a value to you while not making any damage to the others. If you are earning some value, right, by insulting or by damaging the others, it's not a value. Value is the overall value which should give benefits to the everyone. The rights are restricted by the others, right? And the norms, cultural norms, social norms, right, behavioral norms. So all such things, combination is the ethics. Then, by considering all these ethics, if you can prepare your guidelines, that is the moral rules. Those guidelines. When you conduct, when you implement that part in an effective way, that is called the moral conduct. Very integrated system. So, in order to show you the good things, I also follow the same thing what Lord Buddha said. I showed you what are the bad things. Telling bad things, it is very easy to learn good things. And also I showed some good things, two examples in good things, two examples in bad things. Right? And then, the other term given in this the syllabus is the professional integrity. Very difficult word, no? Professional integrity. Integrity is honesty. Right? Professional honesty. What is professional honesty? The quality of being honest or having strong moral principles. That means collection of qualities clustered around truth and fair dealing. Now always you have to make fair dealings. What would be the fair dealings? What is the meaning of marketing? Earning profit. That is the good old concept. Whatever I produce, you must be prepared to buy. That is the old marketing concept. Now the present marketing competence is you have to satisfy the customer. Right? While satisfying the customer, you have to earn profit. That is the, it's not also the latest concept. Right? The latest concept is you have to investigate the customer needs and you have to produce what customer wants. That is the latest principle. But our way is we produce something, if you want you can buy, or otherwise you can leave it and go to behave. That is not the way. The professional integrity also, the quality of being honest. Right? And in a business environment, professional integrity has serious consequences of company success. The success of a company is the professional integrity. Now you can see a lot of companies, right? They start and they make profit. After a couple of years, you can't see even there was a company existed in that area. Right? Because when they earn profit, they just forget about the professional integrity. Right? Then they start to go for the old concept. Whatever the situation, you have to buy in. But you do not know when the company collapses. Now a business that develops a poor reputation in this area is likely to lose customers. Right? Sometimes the word of mouth of the customer is the tool to close the company. It's like that. Always the reputation, you have to get the reputation of the customers. If the customers reject that thought, that means you have no survival. That is the, moreover, a lack of professional integrity in products, services or transaction can have legal consequences of the grave significance, potential resulting in civil or criminal penalties. If you are not honest when you are doing your work, ultimately you will be getting criminal offenses. So very simple things, but you don't think about that term. And now I will give one example. Have you heard about the General Electric Company, the electrical engineers? I think you have heard about this, one of the very old and very reputed company, right? Now the project is staffed with a 60-page booklet that lays the GE's code of conduct and its application in various situations. So the this company, Duo, code of conduct, how to maintain the professional integrity, how a person could be honest person. This company develops a 60-page booklet and train their people to adjust that. Right? Now how many companies do carry out this type of exercise? They will say, please see whether the supervising engineer goes there, do all the concrete, forget about this mixed proportion, right? You won't do on profit, right? And sometimes some officers are, both parties are getting together, right? Consultant and the contractor both get together and do corruption, right? That is called the coercive practices, right? There are so many the dishonest situation, right? Now in the Asian Development Bank, our organization has anti-corruption and integrity policy. We have defined 5 policy rules, right? If you violate those policies, you will be sacked. But there are so many contracting companies, they have violated the professional integrity and ADB has sacked, sometimes permanently, temporarily, for a couple of years, couple of months, right? And certain type of work. And once they disclose a company is blacklisted or temporarily suspended, the organization informs it to all the donor agencies. Right? Our donor partners are the World Bank, JICA, COICA, right? European Union, so all other the donor partners, we inform that. Right? That is the practice. Right? So this is the way of doing good things. So always we have to stick to the doing good things. And in government officers, if you go through the volume 2 of the establishment code, it says there are 22 ways of violating professional integrity. 22 ways. You just take the volume 2 of the establishment code, it's in the place where you can find by the, it's at the Narayan Pita, there is a place that you can buy that one. You get the English version, so only now 65 rupees, very recently I saw that one. They are well established. Once you read that one, you can find out how to escape. Sometimes you do mistakes without any intention. It's a violation of integrity is intentionally, if you did the wrong thing, that is violation of integrity. But in good faith, you do certain things, you take certain actions in good faith, but ultimately it fails, right? But our government officers are always want to catch such people and punish. Right? The establishment code very clearly says, please check whether that person has engaged with this misappropriation with the intention of violating the professional integrity. It's very clearly says. But our officers do not know how to find out whether this person has taken this decision. Right? So I could remember one engineer has taken his vehicle in a situation that he had to pay his salaries by following day. He is in a rural area away from Mundraga, right? Then that person, the following day, to certify the check, there are 2 persons has to sign the check. One is the engineer in charge, then his immediate subordinate and the chief management officer, right? His immediate subordinate has informed him. He is sick. He is unable to report for the deputy on Monday. This was a Sunday. The Sunday afternoon, the chief clerk, the chief management officer, has come to Mahiyangani and given a phone call. Right, sir, there are no buses today. Right, in the night. Right, so I am stuck at Mahiyangani. Then the engineer, what the engineer has done is he has asked, he is trying to find a driver. This driver here, right, has after 6 o'clock. He has taken his usual afternoon, right, the drink, right. The engineer was afraid to send the vehicle by the driver, but if he sell it, he has asked one of his technical assistant take the vehicle and go, right. And on the way, this investigation officers had been moving to some other area. They found the vehicle was broken, stopped that one, took a statement, and it was a big story, right. The technical officer was driving a vehicle. Ultimately, he has got his charge sheet, all such things, right? So at that time, I was working as the Direct Engineering Service Board. So it came to me. So I found this person has done in the good intention, right? If he fails to pay the salaries of this all these employees by Monday, what would be the situation, right? And these people have spent more than to the 4 days, right, for that trip to carry out the investigation. Finally, I said, this person has done this one as in a good faith. Don't punish the person, right? It's the decision, wise decision made by an engineer. You have to appreciate that. There are things like happening. There was another example for that one. I will stop that one. The one young engineer, he was under the probation period, right, working to the one of the provincial councils, right, those days. And the chief secretary has took this person, right, to work for him. The chief secretary is the big person, right, in a provincial council, right. He's the chief accounting officer, like a secretary in a ministry. And in a, the tender document issues, right, this young fellow has refused to issue some the tender documents, right, because the contractor, the bidder, the person who requested the bid has not got the certification from the ICTA. You know the what is ICTA. Because of the delay of the ICTA, he has produced a letter. So then the engineer has, this young fellow, no, I want the document, right? You have to go and get it in advance. Why you stay until last moment? Yes, refused. This person has complained to the chief. Ultimately, all this person got together and got the statement and everything, and set a charge sheet against that person and received to me. The charge sheet says, this young engineer, and the bidding document has to be issued by the chief secretary, right? The engineer cannot, engineer has refused to issue that one, not recommend, so then the chief secretary could not issue that one, right? Chief secretary had issued only the recommendations given by the engineer, this young fellow. And then the charge sheet says, this young fellow has misguided the chief secretary, right? So then I ask a question, the chief secretary is in the special grade of the Sri Lanka Administrative Service, having more than 30 years of experience. How that person is misguided by a young engineer who is having less than 6 months of experience? So this is the careless situation of the chief secretary. And ultimately, chief secretary was found guilty. Engineer was acquitted. Right? Now think about that one. You have to train your subordinates. If you find a small mistake done by that person, and if you are trying to put all the burden on that person, ultimately that person will leave the organization, not even the organization, they leave the country and go away. Right? Now our intention should be to keep retain at least one more engineer in this country for at least one more day. So this is the theme of engineers. If you work like that one, and you can make a good society in future. So thank you very much for listening to my sharing. If you have any question, you have 5 minutes more. Otherwise, if you have already got late, you can leave, no matter. And however, I hope that you will attempt the question number 12 that will be on this subject, and you will share your experience through that answer to that question. Good luck. If you have anything, you can ask. If you don't have anything, if you are hurry to go, yes, please. Seminar was that.
So that's why
it should be. That's the way of doing that. Whenever you see a mistake, you have to bring to the notice of the correct person at the correct time. That's whistleblower. And the other one that I explain you that DHL story, it's an example for the leadership, right? The leading and leadership are two different things. You can play a leading role. The leadership is the latest concept of leadership is much more than to the leading role. The leadership, have you heard about the Lee Iacocca? Lee Iacocca became the CEO of all three leading automobile organizations in USA. Ford, General Motors, Chrysler. All three organizations, he became the CEO, Lee Iacocca. Right? So real leaders. He disregarded all the rules and regulations in order to achieve the purpose. Those are the qualities of leadership. Now this DHL union manager, he does not have any authority to hire aircraft and send them the mails. This is the real leadership quality. But in your PR rules, I found that the candidates are asked to write on leadership, right, under the 5 competencies. So then I said, how an engineer having 4 years experience can write about this leadership? Should be the managerial role. Right? You are not the leaders, no? Right? You will become a leader when you come to the age of 45 or 50. And the, if a question is asked, right, if that question to be asked from a person who has having 45, 50 years experience, you should not ask that question from the young Indians, right? Always, my way is ask the question, right, that is suitable for the least experienced person. Right? Senior person will be right, but there are various reasons that you have not attended the charge. Right? The person, that's not a problem, it's a different matter. Because last time I put so a question, write an article about the. Writing to the journal article, get the transcript. How this junior person can write journal article? Even I can't do that. Always, when you are, please identify the audience and address to the audience. Now, there may be very senior engineers among you, and have you followed any management course? Not at all. So then, to the audience. I learned all these things when I followed the MBA 20 years back. But I never use those terms. I use only the words. It is
any uni engineer cannot do. So if you are trying to show my colors, right, by giving a lecture, the audience, the minimum experience person is 4 years, it's excellent.
I don't know. And if you get a difficult question, please excuse me.
This is not my.
Okay, thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.